All right, Mr. Chair, with your permission, we've had several folks sign up, so we'd like to extend public comment, if that's okay.
Yes.
Okay.
I look forward.
Somewhere we have lost the mic.
Okay.
All right, so again, public comment.
Too heavy news.
We'd like you to step forward and share any of the comments you have. Again, please realize the board is confined within the scope of the rest of the environmental management program. We're going to give you 2 minutes tonight. We have 11 people scheduled to speak. At about the minute 40 mark, I'll kind of wave at you to let you know the time's running out and you can kind of finish your comments. So if you'll just step over to where Julie is and identify yourself, you'll have 2 minutes to address whatever you would like. So let's start with Jeffrey C.
Well, in terms of the presentations that you heard tonight, I think Dennis Carr expressed the most candor when he said we need to have an end state vision in mind. This kind of proposal is coming out of the fact that enormous mistakes were made in the planning of cleanup at this site. And they were made by the politicians and by the Department of Energy, namely that the cleanup was accelerated and funding was increased at the front end before any of the important decisions or public process had occurred to make decisions about what the end state would be or about what the cleanup options would be. So now there's an attempt to backfill and basically invent an end state vision that has not existed. The plan that was proposed tonight is corrosive of community trust, destructive of any community consensus, absent of any statutory authority, violative of democratic process, and insulting to Appalachia. And it's insulting to Appalachia because it presumes that people in this community are dumb enough to all believe that if you build it, they will come. All right? This area has more industrial park overcapacity than any other part of Ohio. Everybody knows that. I participated in the OU study process. Everybody who participated in that study process knew that. And we called upon them to look at the fact that the other industrial parks in the area are largely vacant. So why would you build a new one and spend hundreds of millions of dollars doing that? Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Jim McGraw. Thank you for your efforts a lot, sir. Thank you. My name is Jim McGraw. I'm a longtime resident of Sauter County. I am a elected township trustee in Washington Township, Sauter County. I represent 750 laborers, and we do support the on-site waste sale, but we know that it will create many jobs, good paying jobs at that. And it will be a savings to the taxpayers as well. And this will prepare this site for the new industrial future. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments, Mr. McGraw. I appreciate it. Thank you. Thanks for your technical assistance in the back corner. Mr. Carl Peterson?
Yeah, I'm glad to see that you're going to take a group of people to Fernald. I think that will answer a lot of questions for a lot of people, local landowners. I worked at Fernald. I've been in construction for 31 years. And over the years, you know, you always have inspectors and like the DOE or the Corps or the state. But down there, you know, it's the first time in my life that you had a person from the community while I was working, making sure that things were done right. And they were invited to, you know, the open doors. And they were part of the whole planning process. And I think after you see it, see the landfill, it'll alleviate some concerns. This landfill is going to be, it looked to me like a mile or two from the industrial park. Correct? So it's not like it's going to be right next to the industrial park. And I cannot imagine a landowner around here wanting to leave the groundwater blooms in the ground. I worked it for about a year last year on the 701B, and I cannot imagine that somebody would not want to take that out of the ground, treat it, stabilize it in a landfill to where it cannot escape rather than leave it in the ground, let alone an actual industry wanting to build next to it. I just can't imagine it. And as far as the on-site landfills, some of them are capped, but are they, they're basically like valley fills, aren't they?
They're not lined.
They're not lined, right? So they may have to be removed anyhow, correct? No?
Regulatorily, they have been closed, and they have met the regulatory standards except for treating groundwater.
Okay.
So currently, they do not have to be removed.
Well, I can't imagine a business wanting to build next to a landfill, and your map showed that the industrial park idea would be pretty much destroyed by not doing the landfill. And then the cost, I can't imagine shipping it all off-site. Just the stuff that was above waste acceptance criteria for all that we shipped off-site, there were times that we'd have to wait a month for a car. People just don't even realize the delays with train cars and all of that. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Mark Johnson.
My name is Mark Johnson. I'm a resident of Ross County. I'm the representative for the Tri-State Building and Construction Trades Council. I said at the last meeting that we support the on-site disposal sale. The future vision plan here was very well presented tonight. As a former construction superintendent, I can tell you, you know, you want a building pad that's where you can build a building on, potential build a building on, where you don't have to do engineering design out around an existing landfill or a flume. You want to be able to build wherever in the future, you know, or otherwise you'll have a hodgepodge out here. And the way I look at the community has spoken with the OU study that they wanted this place reindustrialized, you know, and I believe that we've had community input on that fact right there. And I think that that is very important to use in your determination. I think the community has spoken. They wanted this to be reindustrialized. And I support the concept that was here tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. We appreciate it. David Hurd.
Right here.
Sir.
My name is Dave Hurd. I represent the operating engineers out of Columbus. We've got 3,500 members in the southern Ohio. And from what I understand, the unemployment in Pike County is very high right now. And what would help out is reindustrialize this plant out here. The quicker we do it, the better. We would get jobs to the local people here. And also, from what I've read, it's going to be a cost savings of over $1 billion. Do a landfill here on site, and also up to 4 years quicker to do the landfill here on site. So, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate your comments. Lloyd, is it Crabtree?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Hello, my name is Lloyd Crabtree. Some of you may know me as Buster. I'm a lifelong Pike County resident. I'm in full support of the waste sale. A lot of people in these surrounding counties, including this one, have made good livings. Business makes good money. Now it's time to clean it all up. So we're going to just ship it off to Nevada, to the people of Nevada. Other sites, I know Nevada's a big site, but I think the sale will be well supervised. Lots of continuing monitoring on it. So that's my opinion. Thank you.
Thank you. We appreciate your comments, Mr. Crabtree. Dave Williams.
My name is Dave Williams. I'm a community member. Live about 4 miles from the plant. I'm here near Tom. I'd like to say I'm in support of the sale, just mainly due to the fact that the way the regulations are now, as opposed to when the small landfills are built. I'm sure they're by far higher. Just my way of thinking is I'd rather have all the small landfills put in one so it could be monitored or easier. Maybe I'm just a simple way of thinking, but the way they do things now as opposed to the way they did them then, I'm sure, are entirely different. I worked on the D&D out here for the last couple of years and see how the DOE runs things, and I'd say it'd be kind of hard to get much buy-in, so I'd feel a whole lot more comfortable by having that here. And as far as shipping it to Nevada, from what I've seen, the logistics, the time it takes to do stuff like that, didn't seem feasible to me. Thank you a lot.
No, thank you very much, sir. Appreciate your comment. Kim McClure.
Hi, I'm Kim McClure. I'm living in Rosemount here in Soda County, and I am for the sales. I worked at Fernald from 97 to 2006 on the sales. It was a good process. I mean, it's nothing like people understand until they see it. Like Mr. Henderson says, I mean, they're right on top of it. They're highly engineered. We need to work here. We've got a lot of highly trained people, operators, laborers, teamsters that's done this work for a long time. We really need to work in this area. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Blair. Cheryl Anderson.
My name is Cheryl Anderson, nicknamed Shorty. I worked for now 15 years. I did cradle to grave. Pretty much I started out human resources. I did the procedures. I went on to vehicle administration, parking management. I was a D&D coordinator. asbestos abatement supervisor, putting the stuff in the cells, burying it on the on-site disposal facility. And I can tell you right now, we do need the work. It is a win-win situation. I have worked in a lot of different other industries. And let me tell you, floor and DOE and everything, their standards are a lot higher than a lot of other construction companies out there, as far as safety goes, as far as their people goes. And I just want to let y'all know that, like I said, I did everything out there, from writing the procedure, you know, being there with the writing procedures and doing all of the paperwork and stuff, to burying the stuff in the cells. And I'm telling you right now, the cells out there, what you're talking about with the waste cells, that is a heck of a lot better than having an open plume or an open landfill that, you know, you're telling people that, oh, you know, new business doesn't want to be around a cell, a cap cell. They don't want to be around an open landfill either. It's a lot safer, you know, with a cap cell than it is something exposed. And with the, and like I said, the way that floor and the DOE dedicated, it goes right. And like I said, it produces a lot of jobs, and that's what we need right now. We need jobs. It's a win-win situation for everybody. You're going to get jobs right now, but you're also going to provide for the future, the long-term vision, and bringing that economy to this area. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Anderson. I believe you're the first shorty we've had, so glad to have you. John Mount.
Good evening. My name's John Knopf. I have been employed at the facility since December 1972. And my dad was employed there beginning in the 50s with the original workforce. Everybody is in agreement. This is the cleanest DOE site anybody's seen. And I'll tell you the only common denominator to that is my workforce that I've worked with since I've been out there. And I will assure you our current position is we're opposed of burying anything else on that site. I'm sorry to dispute my friends who want to certify DOE and Flora as being capable of doing anything and everything wonderfully legal. I would submit to you that we had labor peace before they showed up recently. We had a 4-year agreement in place. We are now, with Flora and DOE, 1 year into a labor dispute. The slashing of wages and benefits for our folks had nothing to do with disposing of the D&D at that facility. So I would submit to you that they're creating this problem. I realize that's not a problem for the board, but it is a problem in the process going forward when DOE and Flora has created a problem with the existing workforce. They feel terribly disenfranchised in this process. They don't feel that they're being listened to. They don't feel like they're being taken care of. I don't see how DOE and Flora can suggest that they want to take care of the community if they won't take care of the current workforce. We had a promise. GSET, Davies, our good friends in the building trades built it. Our members built the equipment, put it online, did better than anybody expected. What do we have today? Basically, is an empty building. I see in this process here a whole lot of field of dreams, but the reality is the only thing I think that we get out of it is a landfill. And I appreciate that. Anyway, as I would submit to you, I don't see that having the landfill is going to do anything positive for this workforce. We'll wind up with a site, with a landfill, and vacant. I think that anything that resembles bearing anything else on this site is going to be detrimental to the industrialization of the facility. Thank you.
Thank you. David Minute.
Thank you. Dick, congratulations. David Manuva, former chief scientist, research staff on the tour of the site, now running Manuva Chemical Consulting here in Waverly. A few quick points. In the private world that I'm in now, we've got both a mission statement and a vision statement, and we're absolutely focused on both of those. And I think that's essential in any type of operation, that you maintain a constant focus on what's important and that you don't deviate. And that as you make progress, you revisit to make sure that you're not deviating. Now, in the private world, we raise money privately through clients and otherwise in order to move forward on projects. The issue here is going to depend on federal appropriations. And I've heard no discussion of that tonight. And it's going to be problematic in this area because Congresswoman Schmidt was beaten in her primary. We have no idea who's going to be the new congressperson, nor do we know if that individual is going to be in the majority. So without seniority and possibly not in the majority, it doesn't bode well for funding. And that's an absolute concern that I have. Now, quickly addressing Mr. Brushart's issue. The issue with moving the material either by rail or by truck, if there's a derailment, if there's an accident with trucks, quite often I'll be involved in trying to figure out what happened. In most cases, it's a whole lot easier to do as much of either the storage or the treatment on site so that those risks are mitigated in addition to not having the transportation and extended time costs. And so if this is done right, and that's where we go back to the focus, it's got to be done right. There'll basically be one opportunity to do it right, and so we need to be sure about that. And then I heard a number of things for the first time from the FFE engineering group.
About 10 seconds.
Gotcha. Basic issue, whether it's them or any of the other groups, we need to be concerned about groupthink, that any of these conclusions need to be independently derived.
As always, thank you very much. All right, final comments from the board. Thank you, Jude. Yes, Brian.
Yeah, I was one of the two people that attended the habitat tours, and I was actually very pleased with what we saw. I guess there were a total of somewhere between 12 and 16 people total, but there were only two members of the SSAB. I was a little disappointed in that, but I understand it was a weekday and it's hard for people to get out. One of the things I was very impressed with is the diversity of habitats on the site. There's everything from wetlands to brushlands, grasslands, forests in various stages of regrowth. In fact, one of the most impressive things that I saw was a fantastic woodland on the southwest corner of the property near the Southwest Road access that comes in off of, I forget where the road is out there. Anyway, that has got to be some of the most impressive woodlands that I've ever been in Ohio. I've been to a lot of places, I've hiked a lot of trails and things. That is the closest to a virgin forest that I've ever seen. It just tells me that there is more here. There is stuff worth preserving, and we really should, some of that woodland is priceless. And I understand from talking to the gentleman that was doing the surveys is that there's more acreage on that that western slope that slopes towards the river. There's more acreage of that type with that size trees and the high diversity lush undergrowth that was there. One of the things I was disappointed about was to see that the road that the Southwest Road access was actually relatively new, and that it had actually been run right up the little creek and hollow where that old forest was, and which brought me to think, did that forest in fact extend where that road was, and did they in fact run that road through that really beautiful type of woodland? One thing I was wondering was, is there any consultation with the NHPA? I understand that usually before any road or construction or anything is done on the DOE property, that there has to be some sort of consultation process. I was wondering, was there any consultation done before running that road through? Because there was damage to historic property. Those big trees, if they were there, were irreplaceable. So that's my comment on that. I have another comment. Does anybody in here believe that DOE should go ahead and disclose and classify information pertaining to the activities here in Piketon? Does anybody on the board believe that we should go through the actual process of declassification? Wouldn't it be important to know what might be in some of those landfills, the sort of health things that the workers have been in contact with through gauges? I mean, here we are. We're gonna have guys working with this sort of stuff. Shouldn't we know? Shouldn't the public know what may be going into some of these landfills? I understand there's beryllium, there's nickel carbonium, there's a lot of other contaminants. I personally have a friend within the last 2 years has been exposed to beryllium from crawling through those giant concrete tunnels that run underneath the ground. I think people need to know. I think it's important for the community to know what has happened here.
Is that available to Ohio EPA? All right. What's in those landfills?
We have some information. We have the information I believe that Dennis gave to you last month. We have a document that's out there, a description of current conditions. That is a public document that discusses that.
I believe the annual environmental reports also address that.
Some of them, but the classified landfill, we don't classify.
Well,
that's what I'm saying. Could we declassify that? I mean, would DOE go through the motions and actually do something like that?
There's another issue, which is a lot of records of divorce.
Brian, we talked about it. By definition, I don't really discuss classified stuff because it's classified. Now, to the extent we can, it's in our best interest to remove a lot of that, security and you'll face it. The classified stuff that we have left out there, there's technology and for whatever reason, it's believed that you don't want to get it in the hands of some rogue nation because they might use it against us. The other information out there, it's really just personal information. We're all limited on it. I think about my social security number. We're restricted on getting my social security numbers, medical records, that kind of stuff. It's not exciting. To the extent we can, we don't have anything to hide about.
With our proprietary
there's some technology out there that's still classified as a vegetable. I will say to everybody here, you can employ your stuff. I mean, there's a process you go through. If you want information, and hopefully you get a response back, employ your stuff. You need to go to the IG, the GAO. I mean, there are processes out there. It's basically a pain in the butt. But there are processes that you can go through to ask questions like that. And it will go through a vetted process to give you an answer back. But I'm not in a position to be able to talk about stuff.
Okay. I have one more thing. I would like to ask for a tour of the waste cell site for the SSAB. I think it's important for us to see basically where the perimeter of that cell site is, and I'd also like to see possibly what kind of habitats are on that site and in the areas around it which might be affected. I think that would be kind of important for making decisions of whether that's actually a proper place to put something.
The proposed site.
We walked over like maybe even a corner of it. We didn't actually see the site. I mean, we didn't walk the perimeter of it. We walked up the hill, and walked over, and we walked out.
You're in better shape than I am. I thought we walked so good.
It's going to be a 100-acre site. I mean, walk the side of that. It's a half a mile long. It's a quarter mile wide.
You walk the perimeter is what you're talking about? Or?
Basically, yeah. Could we arrange it for a walk?
We'll see what we can do.
I would suggest if we do it. But we'll be developing tours for the new members, so that you might be part of it.
I think it'd be important to actually see the site where that sells.
You could put on full anti-seize, and then that would keep the pigs away before that one.
I'm personally for any tour where we get more action photos.
With the sky out
there. Yeah.
The office walls are now behind you. Yeah, Carol Bryan. We can do that there in the 50 years.
That was something.
Any other comments from the board? Thank you, Brian, for your comments.
I have one bit of information here. The people from OU, one of your school, I received some communication from them concerning the annual site environmental report being summarized by the local high school here in Piketon. What they've requested is that perhaps maybe a couple of board members actually sit in on the class and listen to as they go through a summary of the most recent annual site environmental report. Also, they would like to present their findings also to the one of the subcommittees that will be meeting, and I forget which one.
Probably
be appropriate with Sharon, but she's not here. But I thought this was a pretty nice idea.
Be sure.
As far as those, and we can set something up.
Bob
will.
Yeah. And in his department. It's available with the sheriff's committee, and she's the
advocate. Did you say a particular school? Did you say the Piketon school?
It's Piketon this year. Next year, they're planning on waiver there.
Yeah,
and then get the rest of the four counties.
Matt Benner from Piketon.
Yeah.
So I think it's appropriate that we have a representation in the classroom.
I think for clarification, you said that they would get Piketon regulation and the other counties part of the Piketon. Right.
So Pike County this year, and then Waverly.
Waverly's going to go out to the other counties.
Yeah, Waverly's going to go out.
Okay. Anything